people were like more interested in Google, Facebook, and stuff, which isn't that surprising because even if you have like cat pictures locally on a mesh network, people will still prefer to use the internet to look at cats because well, everybody knows cat pictures on the internet are more superior to your local cat, which is a bit of sad, but I think it's the truth. And so I was thinking about how can we like make local networks more interesting. So what can we use them for that isn't on the internet? And so I had the idea, is there an app that lets us like call somebody over a mesh network, which doesn't even involve the internet? So we can set up our mesh network, so like throwing out routers, they mesh, and then we can use our phones to use it as a telephone network. Might be perfect for disaster recovery or something like that, for example. And and we got a student, and he went on to implement it, and I would say it was successful. The project was called Messenger. It was the idea of Daniel, the student, that was implementing it. And it's Mesh and Messenger, but well, he's from Bavaria and also living in that area, and the people there have problems with spelling. Pronunciation. when you say, they should pronounce Messenger, it comes out Messenger. So yeah, you get the idea where the name came from. And that was his reasoning. And and it was successful. And now we have an app in the F-Droid store that you can look up. It's called Messenger. It was meant to be a technical demo, but it's usable. It still has bugs and such. But this year we have a follow-up project where we want to root out most of the bugs, add more features, stuff like that, like some way to even call people over the internet, but this is more like a fallback or optional thing because we really want to focus on calling people locally. And the thing is that we use direct IP connection. So let me tell that way. You start the app the first time, you enter some name for your own, and then you exchange QR codes with another person, and then you just click the contact, so you tap the contact, and you can call over the network. And how it works is basically that in the QR code, what you transmit is the MAC address of the wireless interface of your phone. So, and then this is used to build up a link local IPv6 address. That looks a bit funny, but well, it's all in the background. The thing is that this IP address can be used in local networks to directly connect to somebody. The drawback is it's only usable on local area networks, so you won't be able to route it in layer 3 networks. But for example, in Freifunk networks, which mostly are based on Batman, and Batman Advanced, emulates a big layer 2 switch, so it works perfectly there. Also, you can use this app like on your home network or company network if it's a layer 2 domain, and just call somebody from some other office or other part of the company without having to rely on the internet. So if you have an internet outage, you can still use a Wi-Fi network to call somebody. So that's kind of neat, and you also don't need IPv4, so you don't need a DHCP server, for example, of any kind. No. Of course, no internet and no server of any kind. Okay, this is basically how it looks like. On the right, you see like the QR code scanner. In the middle is a QR code you can scan, and left is it's a video feed on a computer screen, pointed at a computer screen, and you also have the link down there to the GitHub project. But if you want to try it, the best thing is to just use F-Droid to download it there. But of course, you can get the APK, the installation package, also from GitHub if you like. I've already told you about what the QR code contains, basically name, MAC address, and then we have this. This link local address, this is the lowest address here, this FE80 part. Everybody who is probably into a bit of networking knows this kind of address. There's a MAC address used inside, and it's rather stable. And every device that supports IPv6 has this address automatically. It is a self-assigned address. And usually computers use this address to get another IP address. But OK, this is all network speak, so let's jump over that. And now we try to make it work in layer 3 networks as well. But now we have to think about how can we guess the IP address of the other person when he is in another network. For example, we also have another IPv6 address from a DHCP server, and if there's our own MAC address inside, we can assume that maybe the other party also has this an address of the same scheme. So we could also try that. And there are ideas to support multicast proxies. So, well, anyway, that we can use to use the MAC address to find our opposite part, our contact on the local network or on the other network that is reachable through a gateway. So I guess you're all from different communities, or at least some of you, and maybe you know how IP address assignment works there or with IPv6. And if you have any ideas what kind of way to find another peer we can implement that isn't based on broadcast or something like that, I would be very interested to hear about it. And so we can consider to implement it so it will work on your local network, on your mesh network. Yeah, and now there's another student working on the project to bring it from the technical demo to an application that you can basically use in your daily life, less bugs and stuff, and and anything you can maybe come up with or what the student has time for and is interested to implement, maybe something where you can send also text messages. And I just want to give a small demo. I have two phones. They are both logged in the BattleMesh network here, in what you use to access the internet. And let me show you. I have already exchanged QR codes. So this is what the app looks like with one contact. And now I just tap it. And maybe I do it the other way around because this ringing is louder, so I have proof. Yeah, it was ringing, but it was not audible. Okay, this is also, it's somebody is calling me, and then I can accept. And it's connected. Okay, now we can have a sound test, but let me do it that way. I can enable video, and now I have something like, Yeah, and I can do it both ways, and I can switch between front and rear camera. So that is all the work of the student for this. Let me quit. And it still has some bugs, but basically it works. It's based on IPv6 and WebRTC, and all it does is just one single connection to an IP address, this link local IPv6 address, and that's all it does. And for that, I think it's doing quite well. And I think maybe people can use this app to show other people, hey, these mesh networks, even if you don't have internet, it has value. Can, if a disaster strikes, for example, volcanoes, tornadoes in Germany, very unlikely to happen probably, but let's see how the future works out. Then we can just throw out our Freifunk routers, they mesh, and you can use it as an extensible telephone network. So that's nice. So thank you, everyone, for listening, and I hope you can try it out. And questions? Do we have to use this? Yeah. Is it?
Does anybody in the audience want to try? I don't have an Android phone.
I have to be careful.
I tried and I
achieve to crash the app in 5 seconds.
Oh, awesome. Bug request, pull request, now.
Okay. If the night mode doesn't work on the main menu, then I'm really disappointed.
Okay, that's great. I mean, it's working for me. I can prove you, I can prove it. Okay, I hope it really it doesn't crash. Night mode.
Just night mode. Mac.
Ah wait, yeah, Mac. we fixed. Yeah, it's black here. You see, it's black. But this is a known bug actually, and it was already fixed. So case closed.
Anybody else?
So there will be a new version with less bugs, and yeah. Okay, next one.
You're using WebRTC
yes.
for communication. So this means that one of the phones that acts like a server, and the other one...
No, they're on the same level. Usually WebRTC works over the internet by accessing a centralized server, a so-called signaling server, and also ICE servers for UDP hole punching and stuff like that. But we have disabled that part, and they just connect to each other. I mean, you open a connection, and then they do the audio, video feed stuff. So there's no server involved, and even the roles of these phones, it's not like you have a client and a server there. So there's no server running, essentially.
Do you also have text messaging?
No, that was an idea, but for now we focus on making this app more stable. But it would be a great feature. Depends how much time the student has left to implement it. Yeah, that's the problem with every Android app. I mean, you could use a programming language called Flutter or something. It's a UI framework, I think. But right now, it's Android only, and it will be very hard. Well, you have to basically rewrite it for iOS.
But is it from the restrictiveness of the iOS platform?
It's a different API completely. So you would have to write it... from scratch, but essentially this app doesn't do very much, so it's not hard to rewrite it.
But it's just a general network access interface that it needs to operate. It's
not I'm sorry.
It's just a general network API that it needs. It doesn't need ad hoc or something else. It's
no, just no. Okay. It just you connect to the Wi-Fi like your home access point at home, for example, and then it will try to reach a contact with
so
an IPv6 address.
Yeah, it should work.
And it should work on your at home at your home. Yeah.
And the other thing is, if this GSOC is successful, does it mean that the QR code will in the future contain a public key?
Yes, that's already implemented, but not yet. I mean, we are still waiting for other things to clean up and stuff, so we have a release. And yes, this was the first thing the student was implementing this year.
Cool.
And it's more or less done now. And now he's working on what was it? The internet feature. So as an optional thing, you can enable. Yeah, let's call somebody over the internet. I mean, I've tried with this app to. I mean, you can bypass the scanning of the QR code by copy and pasting the data. And instead of the MAC address, I was able to put in a global IPv6 address and then disabled my firewall. And the other person at the, I think, Bodensee region did the same. And then we were able to have a connection with this app over the internet from Berlin to the Bodensee region over the internet. So that basically works, but of course only if you have public IPv6 addresses and no firewall no net translation at either ends. And that's not really realistic. So we need some server on the internet for that and hole punching and stuff. But it's mostly just something that needs to be enabled. So WebRTC basically has all these features inside already, but currently we just have them shut down so we can have just a direct connection. If that answers your question. Okay, great.
Do you have any plan to like integrate, for instance, access to other application, contact, or to integrate it more with like other application in Android or not? And
I personally don't have any plans in that regard. But if somebody likes to make a pull request, implement a feature, I wouldn't be objecting it. But it should be optional. Because I hate when apps like ask, I really, really need to read your contacts because I don't really trust most apps and they might like send all my contacts to some centralized server to make money, basically.
Yeah, good point.
So. Over there.
Hello.
Hello.
So. Is it UDP?
It's good question. Yeah, I think it's UDP.
Okay. No.
It's WebRTC.
Yeah.
Well, I was thinking about UDP hole punching, but it's a TLS session. Okay.
I see.
But you can have DTLS so with over UDP so. Okay.
WebRTC the box that converts whatever into WebRTC, it didn't support UDP.
Okay, maybe back then WebRTC didn't support UDP, but I haven't looked at the traffic, but I would think that it's UDP because it's the most useful thing for video and audio transmission. It would make sense, and also because. With UDP hole punching, I mean, it's way easier to traverse routing boundaries. So, but yeah, I would have to look it up because I haven't really looked at the traffic. Yeah,
I was just wondering because you okay. said earlier that there's no server created on one of the phones, but
yes.
If you do TCP, then one has to listen and when one connects. So
yeah, of course, you can have a UDP socket and
sure.
Listens for incoming packets.
Yeah, but in that case, you wouldn't. It's connectionless, so then you really could actually. Have but in TCP case you must have a listener on one side at least.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, sure. But okay. I have a listener, but these phones are listening. Are both listening for incoming connections.
Oh, okay.
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
You had this. You showed that there's this QR code
yes.
that you send across, and you mentioned that you can type something in instead. Is there currently a way that if you know somebody is over there on
yeah.
the same network as you, but you don't know their key because
there's no
in a
discovery mechanism in this app,
okay.
And I think it's a good way.
Yeah.
Because discovery, on one point, of course, you don't want to like other people discover you
mm-hmm.
Necessarily, and also discovery usually means you have to use some multicast broadcast mechanism. And for Freifunk, for example, networks or mesh networks in general, you want to like block. All broadcast and most of the multicast packets, at least as most as possible, until you're near breakdown of the TCP/IP stack.
Yeah.
So
okay. That's the last thing I was wondering is given the way that it seems like a lot of Freifunk things do it, it's unicast only except for the extremely minimal.
Yeah, just
so
for neighbor discovery protocol
yeah.
ARP.
So you're only doing unicast on this.
Yeah,
okay.
There's some things you really need, like special broadcast and multicast addresses for TCP/IP to work at all. But everything else is locked down because it will break down the traffic of your mesh network because every node would replicate broadcast traffic, for example. That would be very horrible. And we had it enabled at one time, I mean, when I was starting with Freifunk in our local community, and then I saw like Apple devices announcing themselves over the network, and I was like looking at traffic that says, yeah, this is the iPhone of this person, and this is her printer, and yeah, basically, iMacs and Apple devices are very talk active and want to talk everybody who is on the local network, which the Freifunk networks are, but very big. They want to tell everybody who is this person, and yeah, I want to offer you this and this service. So we had printers on the network, and we could print out pages in some office. We don't know where it was. Yeah. We printed something like a warning. Please please unplug this printer from the public Wi-Fi, which Freifunk basically is. So that's a bad idea, but of course not everybody knows that, or is not aware of that. Okay, so far that's it. I hope you enjoyed it and are ready for the next talk.